Open Door Baptist Podcast features the insightful preaching and teaching of our senior pastor, Jason Murphy. It also comprises of special messages from a number of guest speakers throughout the year. The purpose of this podcast is to be a witness in our community, to encourage others to grow in their relationship with God through the preaching and teaching of His Word, and to serve others in the name of Jesus Christ.
In our series, Lessons from Our Lord. There's many lessons in the Bible, and many of them specifically in the Gospels that the Lord has given to us that might be some 2,000 years old, but could not be more practical and could not be more relevant to today. As I read this passage in Mark chapter 4, I'm fully aware, first of all, of the historical context. I'm aware of the dispensational element of this particular passage as well, but I do believe the principles that we'll see today are going to be of a tremendous help to us, that are very applicable. I know it's the kingdom of heaven, and you can cross-reference that all the way, and you know, until you're content. But point blank, take them as they are. They're principles, and each one of them is for us to look at our own hearts. And we'll see that here today. The lesson of the soil. As we read this passage, I want you to kind of picture in your mind's eye, great crowds of people have gathered together to hear the Lord. And the crowd is so large that Jesus gets in a boat so he can teach the people on the seashore. You can kind of see that in your own mind's eye. And this is mentioned the first time he ever used a parable. And that word parable, please don't miss this. That word parable means to cast alongside. That's what it means, to cast alongside. A parable is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. A parable takes the common everyday events of life. You know what it does? It uses them to illustrate the deep things of God. Jesus often used these. And we're going to consider this particular one today on the soil. It was spoken to the multitudes in public. And keep in mind, and we see in verse number 11 or so, but it was explained to the disciples in private. In explaining the parable, Jesus tells us what each element means. Everyone who heard this parable could immediately relate to what Jesus was teaching. They'd all seen a farmer begin to work and sow seed, and they knew all about it, so it had been something that would have resonated with them. They'd all seen the crops spring up and begin to grow, and Jesus used this very common theme to teach a deep spiritual truth. He tells us, and don't miss it, look at chapter 4, look at verse 14. You're in chapter 4, look at verse 14. He tells us the sower soweth the what? So, keep this in mind, just kind of as a little parenthetical here. The sower can be anybody. I'll say it again. The sower of the seed, and the seed is the what? The seed's the word of God. So the sower can be anybody. And I think sometimes a misconception is that we have relegated the sowing of the seed to the missionary. We've relegated the sowing of the seed to the pastor. We've relegated the sowing of the seed to the evangelist. When in all reality, every single person in here can sow the seed. Where you work, where you live, where you go to school, your neighbors, your relatives, your coworkers, you name it, you can sow the seed. And some people think, well, what good would that do? Well, understand that there's no problem with the seed. When you sow it, something's going to take place. It may be rejection. It may just take a while. It may need some cultivating and watering and so on. But when you sow the seed, something's going to happen. And you don't know what's going to happen. Think about the shoe salesman that led D.L. Moody to Christ. And all the thousands of people that have been saved as a result of just that guy that his job was to sell shoes. Al Hughes, who's over in Port Orchard, who's out of this church, who Jeremy's over there working with him right now, he was saved because somebody simply at his work took a gospel track and gave it to him and said, this tells you how you can know for sure you're going to heaven when you die. And he read the track and got saved. He's been pastoring the church for 30 years now. That was just a layman that he worked with. You have no idea how God can use you if you're willing just to sow the seed. When fruit is absent, the problem does not lie in the seed. All the seed is good seed. Each kernel held the potential to bear fruit. And we're going to see that in just a little bit. The problem was not the seed. I want to say it again. The problem was the what? The soil. Don't miss that. The soil in this parable represents the heart. And something I want you to notice at the very beginning, they all have different things. As we look at my little experiment here, all of these are in the same vessel, right? They're all in the same vessel, which means all of you that can hear me right now, say amen. You can hear me. You all have a heart. And they all are the same in many respects. But they all inside them, all what's inside them is different. What's inside the heart is sometimes different. But the heart, God created for everybody. And so keep this in mind. The soil in this parable represents the heart, but everyone who hears the word hears it in a different way. Now, have you ever considered that? Just pause for just a minute. And this is so important. Everyone who hears the word hears it in a different way, or I should say, responds to it in a different way. And just pause and ponder that thought. Responds to it in a different way. Best way to explain it would be this. Maybe you have some loved ones that aren't saved, okay? How did, you maybe you have a relative that's not saved. They heard the gospel, but they didn't receive it. You heard the gospel, and if you're here today and you're saved, that means that you received it. So why did you receive it and why did somebody not receive it? That's a fair question. Another way to put it is this, and it's kind of a base analogy, it'd be this. Why is it that in Christianity, some people seem to get it and some people seem to not fully get it? You say, what do you mean by that? Some people understand what it means to name the name of Christ, the magnitude of what that means, and others do not fully understand it. They may trust Christ as their Savior, but the soil maybe is not fertile enough for them to bear or produce some 60, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. So why is that? The answer to the question, that age-old question, it's the heart. How's your heart this morning? How's the soil of your heart? Is it fertile? We read in Hosea chapter 10, it says, sow to yourself in righteousness in verse 12. Sow to yourself in righteousness, reap in mercy, break up the fallow ground. There it is. It's time to seek the Lord. So that heart, it needs to be cultivated. It needs to be worked over so it's able to receive it. We'll see in just a little bit here, we'll look at the wayside soil and we'll notice that it's not ready to receive the word. Some get it, some get it, some don't. Why is that? It's the condition of your heart and my heart. Why is it some people, they get on fire for God and they take it serious and they're in their Bible and they're praying and they're witnessing to people around them and they give based on what God's given to them. They're faithful to the Lord. They witness, they pray. Jesus is important to them. And others, it's kind of like a tack on. It's like, yeah, you know, I'm a Christian, but they would never publicly profess or even, you know, why is that? And then I'll tell you, and I'm not trying to be condescending. Please don't misunderstand me. God's desire is that you bear fruit. How many of you agree with that? Say amen. His desire, he wants you to bear fruit. He wants me to bear fruit. It isn't about, well, this person's in the ministry. There can be laymen in the church that produce fruit for the glory of God. It's all a matter of how your soil is, how you receive that engrafted word, how it is cultivated, and then in turn produces fruit. The soil is the primary emphasis of this parable. And as we look through these verses, I want you to Examine yourself. Would you do that today? It's a little bit of a test, if you will, in taking inventory. Ask God, Lord, would you show me today which of these soils is me? Which heart do I represent? Let's evaluate it as we consider a lesson from our Lord, a lesson of the soil. Notice number one in your notes, if you would, we see the hard heart. The hard heart. Lesson number one, the hard heart. Look at Mark chapter 4, verse 4. And it came to pass as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. Now, the wayside sow refers to that narrow footpath that kind of ran through the fields where they were farming and what have you. And you maybe have been to certain areas where they're farming, and you see that soil there, and it's hard. And that seed that comes, don't have a lot in here. I've got some more up there. And it sits and it doesn't go in. It goes down. This is the wayside soil. This is what you would see next to. And sometimes when the sower's sowing, some kind of just go in that trough there or where he's trying to get it. Some falls on the wayside. Does that make sense? It kind of there, but it doesn't produce any fruit. Because there's something wrong with the soil, and the soil is your heart. And you have to ask yourself the question, is my heart hard? Have you ever heard that term? We say, well, that person's got a hard heart. How many of you heard that before? They're hard-hearted. Oh, you want to have a soft heart. You want to have a sensitive heart. You want to have a heart that's compassionate and listening to the Spirit of God as he speaks to you and quick to respond as God speaks to you. This soil represents the heart that has been hardened. And I want you to understand, look at the verse. Would you glance down at verse 15? You're in Mark 4, look at verse 15. And these are they by the wayside, where the word is sown, but when they've heard, okay, so that means they heard it, the seed was sown, Satan cometh immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. Can I say this? As you continue to go through these parables, you'll see it. First of all, and you'll see it in the stony places as well, that seed that would fall on that heart would sit there, and the sun would scorch it, or the fowl of the air would come and snatch it and take it away. Study your Bible, and you'll see that fowl, there's about 30 different fowl in the Bible, and almost all of them refer to demons. They almost all refer to demons. And they come and they snatch it away so it doesn't take root in the heart. And that's important. And so when you preach the gospel or you give a message, they think it's foolish. Well, look at 1 Corinthians 1. Hold your place. Do not leave. We're only going to two passages. But 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians 1. Brother Andrew, while we're turning there, could you grab me some water, please? And then, please. Oh, wow. The Jones, thank you. I was looking for it. You saw me looking. Wow, that is. Praise God for Brother Jones. Man, I took one glance down. Whoa. Thank you. Appreciate that very much. Matthew 25 talks about giving that drink of cold water in my name. Yep, that's good. Thank you. Okay, so follow me. 1 Corinthians 1:18, are you there? Okay, I'm going to join you. So, interesting verse here. And maybe you guys have, maybe you've experienced it before, you've observed it before, but I know I've seen it. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 18, notice what is said here by Paul. He says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish, say the next word. It's foolishness. Foolishness. That's you go tell somebody and you sow some seed and you tell them how to be saved and they think, well, that's foolish. Jesus died on the cross, was buried and rose again. That's foolishness. The Bible addresses that. The preaching of the cross is foolishness to them that perish. But go on. It says, but unto us which are saved, it's the power of God. Praise God. I love hearing the gospel preached. I love it. Tell the old story. I want to hear it again and again and again and again. I loved hearing Pastor Blue every time he said it. When I was 17 years old, he said, I was in Wenatchee, Washington at the First Baptist Church. And he said, I was sitting on the back row and I was with my girlfriend, who's now my wife. And I had my Winstons rolled up in my sleeve. And it was Easter Sunday and it was the fifth stanza of Just As I Am. And I walked down the aisle and I trusted Christ as my Savior. That never gets old. Don't ever get over your salvation. Don't ever get over the day you got saved. Preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it's the power of God. The seed couldn't penetrate that soil. It couldn't germinate. It's a picture of a lost person's heart as well. I hope it's not a picture of your heart. Would you look at number two, the shallow heart. The shallow heart. Number two, look at Mark 4 and verse 5. Go back to Mark 4. And look at verse 5, the shallow heart. And some fell on stony ground, where it had not much earth, and immediately it sprung up, because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. The stony places are common in Palestine. Often there would be an outcropping of limestone rock covered with a kind of like a thin little layer of topsoil. Maybe you've seen it before on a rock. If you're out fishing or taking a hike, you see that, just a thin little layer there. And the soil kind of looks like maybe it'd be ready to be sown, and you could put some seed on there. And as a matter of fact, it may spring up right away. It looks good. Looks like it'll spring up into a promising plant. But because there's no depth, and by the way, it does. We'll see that in just a minute. There's no depth of soil. The sun beats down on that tender plant, as you see in the text, and it withers away and it doesn't produce any fruit. I'll show you here as an example. We'll see this, number two, this thought of this particular soil. The Bible calls this the stony ground. Now, this soil, interesting thing about this, and all the commentaries and all the dialogue I read about this soil, there are those that say, well, you know, this particular, and using it as really as an example of salvation. By the way, the text is not referring to salvation. This stony ground, they say, well, it doesn't refer to somebody who is saved. They say this is a lost person. Well, the interesting thing about it is it produced some fruit, didn't it? Matter of fact, it says it gladly came up, and sure enough, there it is, little fruit there. How many of you ever seen that as you're walking before? I'm not sure what happened to this or that or whatever. You guys probably can't see it. They're giving it a shot, but the devil's in the media. Amen? Hopefully you can see from there. I apologize to those on the sides that maybe can't see it, but you kind of get the point as you read the particular text. Now, here's what's interesting about it. This soil, it says it was received with gladness. Would you glance down at, you're in Mark 4, look if you would at verse 16. This is interesting, verse 16. Now this is, look up here for just a minute, okay. Jesus says privately, he begins to say, here's what this means. He explains it to them. Look at verse 16, he says, and these are likewise which are sown in stony ground, who when they had received the word, immediately receive it with gladness, and have no root in themselves, and so endure for a time. Look up here for just a minute. Have you ever met anybody that they responded, they received it with gladness, and then they endured for time? And then it's kind of like you look around and go, do you remember so-and-so? What happened to so-and-so? I haven't seen so-and-so. Where is so-and-so? By the way, you don't ever want to be so-and-so. Where'd they go? Well, they endured for a time. But I want you to notice, as Jesus says at the end of this parable, he says, afterward, when affliction, we've been studying as a church that word affliction, when affliction or persecution ariseth for the word's sake, immediately they are what? Hey, guess what? They get saved, they tell somebody, they say, yeah, I trusted Christ as my Savior. And when their family or friends maybe aren't elated at their profession of faith, by and by, for the word's sake, they're offended. They've endured for a while, but I'm just not sure, you know, I'm fully for this what would be called by many, say, consecrated Christianity. I want Jesus, but I don't know that I want all of his claims. As he says in Matthew 16, he says, take up thy cross and follow, deny thyself and follow me. Well, I want Jesus in my life, but I don't really, you know, want him that much. And I don't, you know, the preacher always talks about sowing seed or telling others about Jesus. I live my Christianity quietly to myself. And I actually, I'm not against lifestyle evangelism. I'm not. But I also do believe that Jesus and the Bible is replete with verses on the admonition given, go tell it on the mountain. Just in the previous chapter or earlier, he says, who's going to take his light and put it under a bushel? You're going to hide that thing. You know, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Hide it under a bushel, what? No. I'm going to let it shine. Don't let Satan blow it out. I'm going to let it shine. It's just all over the place. But yeah, it's a version, a breed of Christianity that has emerged today. And I'm going to say this just as a side note here. This breed of Christianity that has emerged today has not done a service to the United States of America and the world. The founder, it was Bill Hybels, you can read it himself, when the mega church started becoming huge. And I'll say as a side note here, I'm not opposed to a mega church. The more people that can hear the word of God, I'm for it. Just because somebody's large does not mean they're carnal or that they've compromised. So don't go there. But you look at the fruit that's produced is what you do, and we evaluate that's normal. People say, well, judge not lest you be judged. Get past the book of Matthew. 1 Corinthians 2 says, ye that are spiritual judgeth all things. So you always make judgment. You know, this tomato does not look ripe. All right, you made a judgment. That person cut me off. How dare you judge them? They cut you off. So the list is long. So it's stony ground. It's a stony heart. They receive it with gladness. Maybe they came in and maybe prayed with a friend at an altar or whatever and so on. But they never really produced any fruit. You know, the Lord's been teaching me something lately, and it's hard for me to fully get it. But I'll give you just a side example here, just about salvation. I do believe somebody can get saved sitting in their pew, hearing the gospel preached, God deals with them, they call upon the name of the Lord, and they shall be saved. I believe that. 100%, matter of fact, I know people in this church have been here for 10 years. That's what they did. But that's why I don't always do the invitation like that. Sometimes I have people walk the aisle. Sometimes I go over there. Sometimes I talk to them after the service as the Lord leads. But, and there isn't a biblical plan. There's a traditional plan, but not a biblical laid out of how you're supposed to do the altar call. Please show me that in the Bible. I've read it cover to cover many times. I haven't found it. But I will say this. When you're dealing with a soul, you want to make sure they understand it. I just recently, there was a driver that came by the church, and he comes all the time and drops stuff off, and I've been witnessing to him and giving him tracts, and he was the kind of guy I could always say to him, hey, did you get saved yet? You know, and just talk to him point blank. So about a month and a half ago, he came and it was out by the coffee pot and dropping off a package. And I said, you know, are you ready to get saved? And went through the plan of salvation with him. And it was after men's Bible study, and he bowed his head and trusted Christ as Savior. And he kind of left. It was a little weird when he left. And I was like, you know, and I saw him this Monday. I was in my office and he came by and I said, hey, you know, are you reading your Bible? Are you growing or this? And he says, well, I think Jesus is everywhere. He's in the air. He's like a force. And I thought, maybe I didn't go over this clear enough with him. Now, even if you do walk it through clearly, sometimes with all the things pulling at us, right? You can, you know, so here's the thing. God only knows who's saved. Can we say that? God only knows who is saved. He knows. He knows the heart. He knows the soil. But I know this, as a simple thing, the way to just bring it down. God loves you. Christ died for you. If you ask him to save you, he'll save you. No hoop to jump over, no church to join, no water to go through, no ritual, no. Trust him as your Savior, and he'll save you. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. So the stony ground, many endure for a while. Thirdly, notice the crowded heart. The crowded heart. Mark chapter 4 and verse 7. Mark chapter 4, verse 7. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded how much fruit? Now, this soil looks like it's ready to be sown, but underneath the surface are living roots and the seeds of thorns and weeds. The soil has been tilled, and the thorns have been cut down, and their roots are alive and well just under the surface. When the seed falls here, it springs into life quickly and gives indication that a very good harvest is going to follow. So I want you to notice in this particular one, this is the third kind of soil, which remember, the soil represents the heart. You have the wayside soil. You have the stony ground. And then you have this here. The interesting thing about this particular soil is underneath these thorns, there's a whole bunch of soil here that's nice. And matter of fact, if I go like this, I put some seed in there, you know what it's going to do? It's going to what? It's going to shoot up. It's going to grow. The Jesus is saying something about this particular soil. And if you look at the text, they receive the word, and it's in there, but it eventually never produces really any fruit because there's something that's choking it. Now, the interesting thing about this is he gives us the explanation of what it is that chokes it. Would you glance down? You're in Mark 4. Would you look at verse 18? This is the crowded heart. Is this your heart? Verse 18. And these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things entering in, choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. So the cares of this world, let me just digress for just a minute. I want you just to picture this soil for a minute. The thing about the cares of this world is, it isn't necessarily even sin. It's life. It's life. It's life. It's bills. It's kids. It's family problems. It's marriage problems. It's struggles. It's health. It's finances. It's all of these things. And I can tell you, let me just say this from experience. This has been my heart before. He said, well, what do you mean? Oh, the seed was sown, but you know what I had? I had too many. Do I have a major echo here? Brother Andrew, what's going on? I love you. Thank you. You don't know? Okay. No idea? All right. So, yes, so the devils are in the media. Okay, we can hear it. So, it's crowded. Very simple. I know that my heart has been crowded before. I couldn't, Lord, what's wrong? You know what it was? It was all these ancillary things weighing me down. I love God. I want to serve you. I want to produce fruit, some 30, some 60, some 100, but Lord, I'm struggling here. The word's being choked. I come to church, I'd hear the message, or even in my own private devotions, and I'm like, Lord, I'm not getting anything. And the Lord says, you need to fix your soil. You need to weed your garden, and you need to clean it up, and that way you can produce fruit. Do you know today, in the year 2017, we got things that we're so inundated with that, I mean, it doesn't take much to be bogged down with the cares of this world. You've got your phone, or your television, or your media, or your computer, or your internet, and your phone. I mean, there's no privacy today. 50 years ago, they didn't have what we have today. Where, you know, with all the things we've got, these quick, I can email here, hey Siri, do this, you know, hey Alexa, rub my back, hey, do this, wake me up, you know, whatever, we've got it, email so-and-so, answer this, call this, do this, we've got all these at our fingertips and we're still crunched for time.
And we're just like, what's going on? I can't get it all done. And we're frazzled. And we come to church and we hear a message preached. And sometimes, not always, and sometimes I just try to, you know, be a little bit more encouraging. This is a little more of a sober message, but sometimes we're just like, Lord, I feel inundated. And a lot of times it's just, I've already preached on the monitoring your media intake. That plays a major role in it, that crowded heart. Your phone will tell you when anything goes on. You know, Donald Trump just coughed. Oh, yeah, that's news. Thank you. You know, whatever. It's a crowded heart. I'm afraid sometimes we allow our heart to get crowded. And sometimes for some people, it's the deceitfulness of riches and the lust for other things. And it crowds the heart. They hear a message and their mind is somewhere else. Just over here, because your heart is crowded. You have to break up the fallow ground. You have to be able to cultivate it where you can receive, as James says, that engrafted word to come in there. Otherwise, many things will happen. It'll be crowded out. Satan can take the word and take it away. You'll forget this message sometimes by next week or the next week, and that's okay. I don't remember what I preached 2 weeks ago. I get that, but it's kind of like this. The guy says, well, I'm not going to go to that church anymore. I'm not getting fed. Okay. It's kind of like this. What did your wife feed you the last 30 years? I have no idea. Well, by the looks of it, you got fed. I don't remember. So faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So it's a crowded heart. Lastly, I want us to see, look at verse 8, the fruitful heart. The fruitful heart. Look at verse 8, and other fell on good ground and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased and brought forth some 30 and some 60 and some 100. This particular soil, verse 20, look at verse 20, Jesus explains it. And these are they which are sown on good ground, and such as hear the word and receive it. And then you bring forth fruit, some 30, some 60, and some 100. Some of the seed fell on good ground. This is ground that had been worked and prepared, plowed and tilled to where that seed could germinate here. And this is such good ground. I actually planted these in the 945. So here's my point. This particular heart, and again, obviously you see the moral of the story. Their desire is that this would, Lord, let this be my heart. Let my heart be fertile ground. Let it be ready to receive the seed. And the seed is the word of God. So if the heart is prepared, and as it goes forth, and it lands in the heart, then we bring forth fruit because it's prepared. And Jesus makes that clear. Now, the way you prepare your heart, and this is the best I know how to explain this, the way that you prepare your heart is by number one, prayer. Prayer. I'll give you an example. And I just encourage you to do this, and I'm not trying to browbeat you if you didn't do it today, but hopefully you do it on a regular basis. The thing about human nature is we're very ritualistic, and we need to get in the habit of certain things. So when you go to church, let me encourage you to start doing this if you don't already. Lord, prepare my heart today. Break up the fallow ground in my heart. And I've had this week has just been, you know, Lord, what this week has been. Would you just help me to kind of get this cleaned out, and let's weed this together and get it cleaned out, because when the word's preached, I want to be prepared. And by the way, would you fill our pastor with thy spirit, strengthen him, give him unction from on high and clarity of mind, and Lord, speak to me today. When you do that, I'm not talking about sweet hour of prayer. When you do that, you're just, Lord is listening to you, and you'll get a different message if you'll just do that. I mean that. You'll get a different message if you simply do that. Did you do that today? Did you prepare your heart to your heart's the soil. And the soil is, again, there's multiple verses in Jeremiah and Hosea, break up the fallow ground. It's time to seek the Lord. And so that's what you do. You cultivate it. You work on it. Then you say, Lord, my heart's crowded. The seed's preached today. He gave a message. But this is me, and I'm all crowded here, and things are choking the word. And that's the term it uses, choke. Choking the word. Maybe you're here today and you're one of these four. And you're saying to yourself, Lord, this is where I need to be. And when you pray and ask him, let me say this, he'll listen to you. He wants the best for you. But ultimately, you have to have the discernment and the discretion to evaluate, Lord, where am I at? And he'll respond accordingly. Let's have